Bottom line, design, coordination, or instruction, it's got to be great music played great. Now, my mom, who taught me the value of adverbs, probably should say, Jeremy, that means it should be said greatly. I understand that. But it wouldn't fit nicely. Like that, you already see it's not even. I should have like made the top font a little bit bigger, so I just didn't do that. In all seriousness, the bottom line is the band's worth is based on its sound, and everything else is a support system to that, and we'll move forward with that in mind. When I was teaching, it was make a great DVD. So in fact, I was doing ensemble a couple weeks back with the Phantom Regiment Drum and Bugle Corps, and going through and doing pacing, and you know, just moving, trying to move the rehearsal forward, and said, you know, and it was shoom. I said, bottom line, we've got 8 weeks to make a great DVD, and I had to stop myself because they would have laughed, right? They probably maybe don't even know what a DVD is. So I had to update this to Blu-ray, make a great Blu-ray. This is Sarah Doran when she was a sophomore in the year of 2005. And for anybody that may have a misconception about L.D. Bell, not necessarily the most wealthy school, there's her French horn. I knew Sarah when Sarah was much littler, because her brother John was in the program in the late 90s, which came after the 80s. That's that we were listening to that earlier. John was a drummer, so there's that. And just when you think you got the last rolly chair out of the band hall, you're tuning the flutes, and here in rolls John across, right? And that was going to create a parent conference, the whole thing. And when John's parents came in, this is the late 90s, it was evident that they were not well. So when Sarah came to us, Sarah really needed band, and we really needed Sarah. And there'll be more to that later. But the bottom line is, we must remember our end user. When we are in a design mode, we think we're going to be the making the next Transformers movie on the field. Please keep in mind that it's the students in the community for which you serve are what you are creating things ultimately for. And make that great Blu-ray. Design, right up there with a bunch of other questions, like general effect, right? The myth. This quote from Dan Pink in his latest book, To Sell as Human, I think is appropriate here. To sell well is to convince someone else to part with resources, not to deprive that person, but to leave them better off in the end. So, your first football game in Texas, Friday Night Lights, what are the resources? An engagement from the audience that could be getting nachos, right? And then if you do get past that, once all of the elements come together for an effect moment, there is a level of applause that an individual is able to distribute. And it is up to us to figure out how to design properly so that the students can be rewarded for that achievement. And we'll go ahead and just talk about it. It's also competitive music education for many of us. And we take a look at those BOA sheets, and each of those judges has 20 points with which to deal. So at what level are you going to be able to put a product together for your students to be successful, to be able to have that adjudicator part with their resources of points? I say that to say this. I would explain to our students from the beginning of the season that the adjudicators are actually your fans. They're there for you. They don't want to sit through 18 hours of boring and not great marching band. They want to sit through a prelims and finals of awesomeness. So just get awesome and give them something to react to. In fact, the same things that your parents are going to react to on Friday night are the same things that they're going to react to on Saturday morning, afternoon, evening, and hopefully late evening, right? I would be remiss as we approach this design process if I did not mention and thank my partner in crime for the last, seems like nearly 20 years, at least since 2001, Wes Cartwright and I have been involved on different projects, and Many of you may have remembered him from Santa Clara in the late 80s, Union High School in the bulk of the 90s, and L.D. Bell, Broken Arrow for the aughts? Is that what the young kids are calling it nowadays? Just fantastic. We're going to hear from him a little bit later. So I was going to say at this point, you might be better off to just go download his podcasts on the Marching Roundtable and then leave and listen to those and come back for the very end. But we have some super secret audio files from him that Tim Hinton's not going to get. So you want to stay, sit back down, sit down, stay here, please. Thank you. Appreciate that. He was about to go. Clearly some other great collaborators over the years. Principally Wes, Donald Hill, ASCAP, our composer arranger for a number of years, and we'll hear from him briefly toward the end of our session today. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention certainly the percussion folks, both on staff through the years, John Pollard, Nick Thomas, and Jaime Alvarez Calderon, and some of our designers, such as Brett Kuhn over the years, Jim Casella, just fabulous to put up with some of the stuff that we were doing. And last but not least, I put this on a little flashy thing right there, Daryl Fife. Daryl Fife, thanks to Daryl Fife. Daryl Fife was the drum major of the L.D. Bell Band in the late 70s. And then his students went through the program. And I recall in like 2002, him reaching out when his daughter was a sophomore. I'm like, all right, creepy weird guy that plays trombone and does IT and websites, right? That seems a little odd to me. Well, he hung around and he was very helpful, useful. He became an associate and a dear, dear friend. He's helped with a lot of the video that you're gonna see here. And years ago, before I knew how to use PowerPoint, you can tell I've learned, right? years ago, before I knew how to use PowerPoint, he would run PowerPoint presentations for me, like at the Texas Band Masters Association. I mean, he's that guy. He gets in the car with you, he goes. So I had to take at least 30 seconds of this 90 minutes that we have together. To appreciate that. I mean, he was helping me with video up until about midnight, 1 o'clock last night, when I was like, oh, what about this one? What about this one? So thanks, Daryl. This is a toughie. Something out of nothing. I think spirit there is pretty important, right? The essence, the vibe, as it were. Color, verb, number. Color, one of our shows, 2004, Blue, became that way because 2003 was a little dark, did a lot of Samuel Barber, and we wanted to really lighten things up the next year. We wanted that first Friday Night Football game to be like, yes, accessible music that we've heard before, get to that first contest, you know, and it's up when the performance value may not be there. So we're like, all right, blue shades, here we go, let's do that. You know, we could open with Rhapsody in Blue. People will know that. We can meld them together so there's no transition and go through. Great, well, what's the ballad going to be? What's the closer? Blue, when we started coming up. Trust me, every song that has blue in the title is on that device somewhere. The music from the Thin Blue Line, Blue Man Group. I mean, the hits went on, and some of them weren't hits. So thankfully, by 2004, we had the Google. So we were able to get going. And this is where the fun came in, finding the music from Dark Blue World, a Czechoslovakian World War II film. Andrei Sukup is the composer there. So you want to check that out. I don't know that it's been used since. That music is gorgeous. And then the closer, Blue Cathedral, Jennifer Higdon, who at the time was an up-and-coming, kind of famous orchestral composer, and now is an arrived orchestral composer, and reaching out to her and trying to explain to her what it is that we were doing, right? There's a little bit of a disconnect in that world. And like, we sent her a DVD, like with the concert band and with one of the marching programs, like, this is what we're trying to do. We want to expose our students to great music, and your music is great, rather than having something composed for them out of nothing that ultimately, let's just be honest, does not always result in great music. We know that we can adapt yours. So that was kind of a cool interaction. So for us, the show titles were the concepts, generally. Transcendence, there's the blue, the quest, right? It evokes an emotional response immediately just from the title. Quick about the remaining. Those of you who are familiar with Texas know the University Interscholastic League, UIL, and kind of the announcement personification of itself. It's like the next band in Conference 5A is the LD, right? So I put at the region contest, the remaining as the title, and in parentheses I said real spooky-like. So it was like, LD Bell and their show, The Remaining. was it Ron Burgundy will read what is in front of him? So that is James Seiler, I think Hound of Heaven, the trumpet, handing straight off into Beautiful from King Kong, a little flute solo, melded seamlessly into A Beautiful Mind, James Horner. So what I love about this moment, because we're going to see it, you notice I didn't show it to you, that it didn't look like nothing, there's more to it, that one trumpet soloist, one flute soloist, and most bands have at least two people, right? Can make that moment happen, then into a small woodwind feature. Now, you can say what you like, or like what you say, or don't like what you say about the visual here. You'll see that it either A, complements, B, grades the other way, but C, you cannot deny that it elevates once we marry the music visual. Likely not what you would have expected to see, unless you'd seen the show before. And that's important because the unexpected is certainly a tool that can be used. Now, we'll talk later about giving people what they want. And sometimes they don't know what they want. And that was an instance where that, at least in our neck of the woods, had not been seen before. So there was an engagement, right? Like you could tell there was probably more than a handful of people at the show that evening in Indianapolis, and there were quite a few pin drop moments like that where we were able to move up into an arrival and then transition seamlessly like a fade to black in a movie to the next thing, and all connected musically, which is incredibly important. Courtney was the flute soloist there. She went to North Texas. She's now a band director in the North Texas area. And if I could just humbly, pridefully, we've got about 20 practicing arts educators from that time that are now in service. And it's really gratifying because it makes you kind of feel like some of the things that you did mattered, maybe even a little more than you thought at the time. An emotional response. Let's picture it. October 15th, 2006, I'm literally getting on a plane at Dallas-Fort Worth Airport to go visit my close personal friend, Gary Markham, and six more of my new closest personal friends for the next 2 days at the St. Louis Super Regional. I get a call from Wes Cartwright, and that's before iPhones, guys, right? So it was even more impersonal, and you're like, do I have time for this? This could be a couple hours, and I don't, you know. So I go ahead and I answer the call, And he essentially says, I've figured out the end. Here's what we're going to need to do. I said, okay, this all sounds terrific. A, there's a cost involved with this. So we're going to need to talk with the booster board, kind of figure out how to square this circle. B, will this material be able to be used again, et cetera, right? And you know, the key thing here is that as he's about to talk about this, recall that this is all musically driven up to this point, and then we'll get to that point. Deal?
And I told Jeremey that I'd figured out the ending as I was flying 34,000 feet in the air. I remember that day, and I looked over out the window, and there was just a sea of clouds and white, and it just came to me, really, that we need to cover the whole field in with a white sheet, because I got pretty much tired the whole season of everybody thinking Bell's show is so uncomfortable and it's so dark and people didn't like dark. And I think in the end that kind of got us literally because people were uncomfortable. So I thought, let's bring hope and salvation over the entire RCA dome and really bring this full circle. And the thing I'm most proud of that night, because what was funny about that situation is that literally was the first time that we did that effect. And we'd practiced it only a few times, but in a performance situation, that's the first time, including changing costumes for the solo dancer that came on top of it. But going back to the dark situation, which really was only showing much range and depth to conceptual programming, because the year before was an ascension. So here were the remaining. And the thing I'm most proud of that year in 2006, because it truly is my favorite show, maybe one of two in the last 10 years at BOA, that the audience and their response and their reaction was amazing, because the one thing I am proud about LD Bells, we literally captured the interest, intrigue in the audience, and they were just there for every second of that ending effect, and usually in the shows and what we did, because the emotional effect that was programmed into it musically and visually. And when that sheet came out and everybody was there, and then the crowd at the end, once they did realize that the show was over, was something that I will never forget.
So musically driven, you're gonna hear Beautiful Mind, and it's just a little half step motive going on. Sheet comes out, and then we're going to stop and talk about some more effects, but check out effect one. All right, beautiful piano underneath. So it can't just be that you have a big white sheet. There needs to be a little bit more to it. So the female dance soloist will change from burgundy to white while this is happening. She'll emerge. That's going to be the next effect. And one could argue that silence, which is organized sound, which is music. Next, we have the trumpet and the James Seiler Hound of Heaven get back down to the tonic. Gonna let that sit. We're gonna hear a chime. Yes, real chimes, right? That aren't generated by a synthesizer that a student actually plays. Up a half step to add a little bit of uncomfortable grind to it. And then the solo dancer's gonna continue to run until she cannot run anymore. We will not see her fall, but you'll know when she does by the audience reaction. One other key thing here, we talked about an emotional response. First chime you'll hear, some of the wind players rise. Second chime you hear, we don't see it in the frame, but the guard rises underneath the sheet. And there's an audible, which had to have been pretty loud if it got picked up by the the mics for the band. And then there's the completion. Here we go. what allows for a moment like that to work is everything that built up to it, right? The excellence, the sound, the performance quality. Then on to coordination. Really getting the music visual right is the main thing. And we'll talk a little bit about later. Sometimes it's better to cut your losses rather than working on something you know is not ultimately going to work and just take a rehearsal or two gutting it and putting it, reconstructing it, putting it back together. So putting these elements together, the concept, the I'm really sorry I keep wandering around in front of you. Concept, music, feel, but I have my Fitbit that I got for Father's Day. I'm not sure what that says, but that's what I have. So concept, music, feel, color, and traditions. Important to know if you walk into a new program and ask questions about what those traditions are. You know, for example, Kennesaw Mountain High School is always going to work their melody from Somewhere Over the Rainbow, something along those lines. It's going to be there somewhere, right? And if you're the new director at Kennesaw and you didn't know that, that's be an issue. First impression, most important. So this is 2006, and we knew the band was kind of getting kind of good. We've been teaching them how to play. So now it's time to show that off. The entire beginning of the show leads to the brass and woodwinds all the way up front and doing what they can do. Here's the main point here, the first impression. I'm gonna flip this back. What I would like for you to hear, there's a quote from Samuel Barber being played by the trumpet, like off into the distance. Dee-da-da-da-dee-da-da-dee-dee-da-da. And this is in 03, like way before the pre-show, okay? But we wanted to be real organized as we came out, and it was about having a production value to what you were doing, an aesthetic, that it mattered from the time that you came out of the tunnel and presented yourselves as your school's marching ensemble to when you left and then went and bid teenagers again, right? So we had five soloists the whole minute prior to the show playing quotes from the five works from Samuel Barber that we were playing, just so it filled the room with an essence of something's about to happen. Very similar to at a theater or orchestra concert after intermission where they're gonna dim the lights a couple times. You're like, okay, here we go, game on. Here comes Mahler. So I'll just let you hear that one more time.
Joining us from Hearst, Texas, please welcome the L.D. Bell High School Marching Band.
Joining us. We didn't time that. It just, you know, sometimes it's better to be lucky than good, right? So that's okay. Then there's the old running start. And Don Hill's going to talk about this a little bit later, so I won't tell you how we got there. But sometimes it's fun to see if we can time the announcement with the downbeat.
And the L.D. Bell High School Blue Raider Band.
Okay, we talked earlier about the real goal is to make a great what? Blu-ray, make a great Blu-ray. Why is that important here? There's Sarah from 2005, helped her, shepherded her along. I said that Sarah needed band as we needed Sarah. There was Sarah, drum major of the group that year. Awesome kid. And I would just like to document, I did get her contact information and ask if we could use her pictures today. So that's there if MFA is concerned. So I have her phone number. I've got some text messages. So it's all good. Yes. Hello, Chairman Doster. Thank you for being here today. You knew you were going to get some more 80s music, right?
Yeah.
So as we mentioned earlier, that fade to black in a movie. Here's this big arrival, and then how are we going to use our tools to move into our next contrast in a way that isn't just contrast, but is inviting to the listener, the watcher, to be part and be engaged. This is 2008, toward the beginning. It's a series of transitions. As if the game was, let's see if we can start from nothing, and how long can we slow burn this, right? And then we're going to add the brass, and then we're going to add the percussion, and then we're going to add the visual to layer and enhance to the point where when there's finally a release, you do get that applause point, right? We talked about Dan Pink, To Sell Is Human. Well, what are we selling to that audience, right? That emotional engagement, and then ultimately a level of appreciation. This is 2009. It's the last show I was part of creating, so credit to Van Matthews and the team for putting this together. So very similar to that 2008 style where it's kind of just a series of transitions that goes from one to the next, very musically driven. You can hear the percussion, then that beautiful oboe solo. That was James Horner, Beyond Borders. The specific track is Ethiopia 3, Roman numeral with lowercase letters. I recall finding that piece in November, Thanksgiving of 2006. We just finished Grand Nationals. You get home, and what are you going to do, right? You're going to go try to find some music. So I had that kind of in my back pocket, and it just wasn't appropriate for the next few years. And finally, for this show, it was appropriate. There's another great one that if you want to put in your back pocket, it's Flight Plan by James Horner. It's fantastic. The ballad is called Mother and Child. And you kind of have to think, listen to it, and imagine it activity-ized, and I say that in a real positive way for marching band, because it's just gorgeous music when scored appropriately. We actually used that in 2014 with the Phantom Regiment Drum and Bugle Corps for their ballad, and I don't know that it's been done again since then, so there you go. Highlight your strengths. So like this year with Phantom Regiment, you know, Tony Hall was asking our visual coordinator, is there anybody in the Corps that does anything unique or special? You know, besides sound grade, right? We'd hope that would be the case. And that's a question that you kind of need to ask, and then how can you leverage that in terms of performance and build at least a part of your show around? So for us, this is 2004, that is Missy Thompson. Missy Thompson played the oboe. She got pretty good, was an English horn player in the top band by her senior year. Well, she was also a dancer and studied, and her mom, fantastic, color guard mom, doing all the sewing, was there doing all the stuff. If you have a great dancer, let them dance. So this little one, in her individual contest at the North Texas Color Guard Association, we later let a little outfit from Rockford, Illinois, borrow as their featured soloist for a few years. She later went to a small university south of here, majored in dance, and is now a professional dancer, married to Noah. This is Missy Trulock now. I showed up to Phantom Regiment camp the first day, and she was standing there. I was, Missy? says, because she's an instructor. She teaches. She goes back and gives back. This next one falls under the category of highlight your strengths, but there's a couple wins here. And I do believe this. In the year 2016, we cannot just think win-win. We've got to think win-win-win. There needs to be a third thing that's of benefit in order for us to really consider doing something. So what you're going to see is a trio of soloists performing, and then the visual that goes along with it. Whatever for the visual, sorry, Wes. The trio of soloists, and here's what that was. Toward the last few years I was teaching, the group was growing. We'd gone from 190 in 2003 to 300 or so in 2007. So, and you know the geometry of things, right? There's only so many drill spots that make sense for all these things. So we needed to figure out some creative ways to make more spots so we could involve as many students as physically possible. One of the ways we did that was with our all-staters, like they were as juniors, that the conversation would be, you're going to be a star, you're going to be on the big screen, you're going to be the camera, you're going to be on the DVD. Still at that time, there was no Blu-rays. You're going to be on the DVD, but you're not going to march because that is going to create a space for somebody else. And we're going to use you in an instructional capacity, help to learn, teach drill, do errands, mini drum major, whatever you want to think about yourself. So we had four of those. So that created another four spots for four more students to participate. The other thing that it did from a design standpoint, so win-win-win, right? So we're featuring our strengths. We are creating spaces for more students to participate actively. And then the third win was we didn't need to concern ourselves with getting soloists or trios or duets on and off the field in terms of drill design. Right? And we've all been there, right? Oh, this solo is going to be great. And then the drill goes away and then, right? They have to go find it, chase after it. So here's an example of that. Just beautiful. There's a fourth win there is from a music design standpoint. If something's not working, you have four good sounding soloists for which to design a solo for, whichever would be most idiomatically correct for that part of the show. Now, don't go home and say, well, Jeremey said that you need to stand on the sideline the whole show. That's not what that's not what we're talking about here. Then give the people what they want, and that is okay to do. I have heard, and I think this is science, that an arrival point in a ballad plus big flags equals applause, right? Like we're just, there's something just inside us, right? Like, you know, you could probably see some cave drawings of double flags, you know? So they liked it in 2004, they liked it in 2008. I just never liked resolving anything. I wanted people to be as uncomfortable as possible for 11 minutes. If you would indulge me, I would like to go back and play that again. And if we could, let's close our eyes because this works with no visual whatsoever. This music, I think, is still from A Beautiful Mind. But what I want you to listen for is the phrase shape and growth through the phrase, right? So here we go. No peeking. Thank you. And with all respect to the video crew that day, that was a pretty large ensemble spread all over the place, so we didn't get kind of the full effect, but you get at least the Diet Coke version of what that was. And I say that to say this, the double flags by themselves really don't work without everything else sounding awesome, right? So make sure that as we're getting the big effect that we're also being incredibly musical at the same time. The old FTL, follow the leader. It's the lazy band director's effect tool, all right? Because here's the beauty of the follow the leader. You teach them one set, and then as you know, you teach them the next set, and then what happens for the third set? You go back to the previous set, right? So if you're gonna get evaluated, for example, right, and you need some student-directed learning for their outcomes, for their learning outcomes, you have your principal or someone come out, we're gonna teach follow the leader. You teach the first set, you teach the second set, and then as a student, where do you think we're gonna go next, right? And they could point to it. Now, if they don't know to follow the path back, don't have your principal out on that day, because that could, well, here we go. And what I personally loved about using that effect was it was all student driven, right? Like there was playing, there was marching, it was as classic of what it is that marching band is, because it is marching band. Do let me point that out for anybody who has forgotten that marching and band, it's not like Reese's peanut butter cups that you could separate out, right? Like they are put together. There's been a chemical reaction. It's more like a piece of popcorn when it's popped. That's marching band, right? You don't get one or the other. Well, thanks to Myron Rosander, we now know. Not that Myron's drill was the easiest to clean. I would like to tell you that that was an early season performance, but it was still effective, right? And that effect is going to allow for performance as long as there's effort and energy to still make it up into the stands. So moving along. No one cares about your program more than you do. But I paid this arranger X to do this. Well, you could have paid them 5X. They don't care anymore about what it is that you're doing. It's a job. So when you get the music and it's not exactly what you want, I'm going to encourage you to do some of the things that I'm about to embarrassingly show you that I did, which is simply to sing over the top of stuff and send that back out, or to sing ahead of time and send it out. And even if you get a stock show, that you can find ways to augment, add layers, add more depth and complexity and more interest, and for yourself, be a creator of what it is that you've been given. And I say that under this umbrella. You don't have to accept what's been given to you. That's your choice. You can change it. So I'd send Don Hill these voice-over memos, and do understand that this is a 2004 MacBook, right? And so just when video had become a thing, so I had woke up early that morning and decided to try something different for Don. Okay, maybe a movie will be a little more fun this time. Da 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 So a couple things there. We added depth to already really a piece that could have stood up all by itself, right? You involved more performers. We heard and got to sample our different choirs, trumpet, French horn, low brass, you know, tenors, and then finally the basses. And at some level, it's just not appropriate to go a minute without hearing an acoustic instrument. I'm just old school like that. Some bonus material for Don. That was just being difficult. I could just picture him in his little pretentious LA studio. Oh, file from Jeremy. Oh, no. I am thankful that the technology had just gotten up enough that this survived this long, right? So that was pretty cool. I'd like to say don't tell anybody about this, but these folks with the cameras will probably tell someone about this. So, all right. I've got one more, if you'll indulge me. This one's just a voiceover. It takes about 2.5 minutes, and then we can see the end product right after. Can we sit through that? Is that gonna be okay? All right.
Okay, this one hit me at 4:30 this morning, got me up, so it might be something to it. Part three, doing the voice stuff with the cannon effect on the pans. Dee-da-da-da-da-da-dee-da-da-da. Then we look at the next part, which is the brass from the Rachmaninoff currently, but maybe we need to use the material from further and long, long ago. Okay, this business here, perhaps switching to 4-4 at the brass is not the right thing to do. Maybe we need to stay in 3 so that, you know, all right, so you have that 3 feel, then da 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 dee da 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 dee da 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 dum da 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 dum da 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 da. Then to the Rachmaninoff, you know, woodwinds better da 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 dee da 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 da. Almost like those would be harpsichord lines, broke kind of feel there, and you know, using a lot of the same material that we have already in part three, just creating it into the, into an agogic one feel for, you know, for the 3. Chum, ba-da-da-da-chum. And where the visual cut thing here is going to be to build all of this up into an arrival like 2004 as it relates to music visual and a huge arrival. So obviously we need to get the bottom needs to drop out just a little bit before the big arrival. The big arrival can be the pan stuff in 4-4. So you've got the build jum-ba-da-da-da-jum-ba-da-da-da-jum-ba-da-da-da-dee-da-da-da-dee-dum. So almost like it's the dotted quarter note to what was the...
This one goes under the heading of At First You Don't Succeed. We were very fortunate to be part of a consortium to arrange Lux Arumque by Eric Whitaker for Wind Band. It was Gary Green 2005 All-State Texas fan. And so then in 2005, we used it, and we really didn't have enough time to get it right, so we used it again in 2007, and I'll let Wes talk about that real quick.
To me, Luke's kind of captured Bell's signature piece of music that captured all of those years to me because of its emotional depth, because of its range, its richness, its power. It was soothing and kind of all those things that kind of went into the programming of Bell for all of those years. And we started in 2005, used it for a little bit at the end because we added it at the last minute, especially when you have 8 hours a week to practice, because I know a lot of people don't like to hear that, but literally it was 8 hours. Now that I watch these videos, I don't know how we did all that. And then 2007, we did Luke's again to be able to develop that and make more of that piece of music. The thing about Bell, that the mystique of it all, is to be able to create a movie, and sometimes the movie went first and the character and the visual went first, and sometimes the music went first, and all of those textures, both musically and visually, the feel of the programming, because there really was no thing as transition, because you watch those years back in the back, the moment that you're in already has the next moment in it. And it was more than band, because I really don't like watching or listening to marching band, so I have to be intrigued the entire time, and that kind of inspires the programming part of what I do. And Bell was so special over all those years in what we could do in such a short amount of time, and just being able to capture the audience at the end of the shows, almost all of those years, it was just so unexpected, and it was so quiet, and it was so great to hear the RCA Dome being quiet, and this the things that we accomplished, and it was hard in that short amount of time, and it will always be special.
So we'll hear and see 2005 with the Lukes, and then we're going to go into 7. I'll explain it so we can just do it back to back. The key thing here is the work that is being done is appropriate to the music. Some might call it simple. I will call it appropriate. And it's stuff that any group can do. You don't have to be able to throw a 9 to be able to pull off emotion. All right. So you'll see 5 for what it was, and then 7 we were able to develop further. We were able to then move into the Pan's Labyrinth and kind of bookend things a little bit. And there's a little bit of connective tissue that we added literally on the bus on the way to Indianapolis. There's a saxophone solo that you're going to see that John Park plays. And you'll notice that that's not Eric Whitaker's original material, but we needed some melodic connective tissue to get from one thing to the next. As we said, the transitions need to be musically driven. You'll also see at the end of the 2007 show, the white sheet from 2006 recycled, reduce, reuse, recycled in a different way.
Thank you.
This is Jillian. So this was last Saturday. I left Rockford, Illinois at 6:30 in the morning, hit the 8:30 and was at her wedding by noon. She just got married. There's me with a selfie, and that's my daughter Kirsten with her. Cool part of this story is that Jillian was in junior high at the time, and her older sister, Jessica, was a flute player in the band, a marching member. And then, if you know the show or want to check it out later, at the very end for finals, we had her transcend, and she basically became all white and in miniature form was her little sister, JC, who was in elementary school at the time, who, poor thing, had to sit underneath for finals, the back podium, underneath a white cloud the whole time. But it was a great thing for the family, right? So they were all able to come out and be part. I remember for the evening, for the encore performance, JC ran up to my wife, because I think she was her music teacher at the time, and said, I don't want to sit underneath that sheet again. So like, it's okay. People have seen you already. You can just kind of, so they just, I think she just kind of sat up on the back podium with her little legs kind of going. So so there's always a story. There's always something very human to what it is that we're doing. And that's that key thing is that end user and making a great Blu-ray. So essentially what we're talking about here is instructional design. How are we going to conceive of methods and tools to allow our students to achieve at high levels, the whole instructional process? What do we want them to sound like? What do we want them to look like? And creating a common vernacular within your own program or department and a cluster concept way or a feeder pattern way. And if you are Mr. or Miss Music in Mule Shoe, Texas, and you are the person, then that's great because it's all your information, but that's great because it's all on you. And if you're not, the more people that we have on the team, sometimes the more difficult it becomes to get the same information to the students. How do we want them to sound? We want them to sound awesome. Dark, rich, resonant, powerful, delicate. For me, for us, it was the ARCs of fundamentals. So R bands, Remingtons, the Chinkowitz, and the Clark studies. You would not come to a warm-up and hear from us a six-note sequence of notes that got louder and louder and louder. You would not have come and seen slurs that went as fast as possible that really no one was achieving. And technique for technique's sake. Everything was very dialed in. It was very calm, sort of, and it was very purposeful. In the year of 1999, the method book for band Foundations of Superior Performance came out, okay? Someone had mentioned it to me, and I said, okay, let me give this a try. I was, at that point, was assistant at LD Bell, did the marching band, and here we go. Let's hand this thing out. Oh, wow, yeah, because it's basically just the conglomeration of all great things that bands do. And it went so well that year that we arranged it for the full marching band for 2000. And it worked so well in 2000, we crossed out LD Bell on the top and wrote Central Junior High and Hearst Junior High and Bedford Junior High for the parts that were appropriate developmentally so that the students in the network or cluster were getting all the same fundamental routines and the same vernacular. And I remember it clear as day, the first time we hit a downbeat on the warm-up in 2002, right, 2 years later. Wow, here we go. Now we're cooking with gas, or somewhat ever the Texas people say. it was a real aha moment for me specifically at that time. And it was the Remingtons, it was the Chinkowitz air velocity studies. These here are our band exercises. Well, my trumpet professor, Dr. Leonard Candelaria at North Texas, was very insistent that we start with an airflow and then add articulation and then start to move, right? So what we've done here is just started off with repeated articulations so that we get in the top of the tip of the tongue, right where the mountain range and your teeth, right? We're going to articulate in the exact same spot every single time and have good positive airflow to go through. We're going to organize and make sure we all do our breath on count eight of the phrase or count four of the measure. I am very grateful that in secret in 2008 in semifinals, Dan Potter was able to come in and document some of this. So it's not just me telling you that this is what we did. So here's how it happened.
Backstage, L.D. Bell preparing for semifinals.
Paul
Bell and residents, pull the tree out of the ground.
Oh. And left and green and blue.
Okay, a couple things here. One is that's all of the performers on unison. That's dangerous. And it's also great because everybody has to sound the same. They have to. You have no choice. So here we go. We're not giving the second part warm up. Everybody's doing the same. Two, and this is a shout out to competitive music education when used appropriately. The students will pay attention to you most of the time. They're very dutiful mostly. But in a competitive situation like this, there's no announcement that comes over. No one's sending a pass to the warm-up area for someone to go to finish work in another class. No one's going to the nurse. Everybody's got their game face on and they're going. And over the course of the season, in my opinion, in my experience, the information that you've been consistently been giving them, that they've been getting since seventh grade. Interestingly, you may like to know that in the Bell network or cluster, we begin band in seventh grade. So it's 7, 8, 9, and then the secondary band is 10, 11, 12 is the marching band. So they've been getting all the same information all the time. And what I'd say to them is the power of the network is behind you. You've been given great information over the course of your band career. Now is the time to pull that all together, and there's a focus level to when you repeat all that same information the same way that it can really congeal. And now, let's walk out onto the field and show it off. So it's less a competition at that point, it's a performance. I really like concert contests at in Texas, it's concert and sight reading contest. Concert and sight reading contest. We're going to perform a concert. Go show off everything that you know. They're your fans. Give them something to reward. This next sequence is that R band study. And I noticed also in the warm-ups that I showed you a little bit earlier, we had no lifted notes. So what we did was we inserted them, and you'll hear them on the back side of this, the B side. And, you know, they're going to create their own distractions if you don't create them for them. And it's not about controlling them. You can't do that. But you can organize them and give them some downtimes and some release time, even in this really potentially pressure cooker situation that it's okay to be a human being, go have fun, be a kid for a little while, and come on back. So for what it's worth, there's that. It's probably not in the handout, but it's important. Mr. Farrell, any thoughts about that?
This video is intended to help reinforce the basics of marching fundamentals for members of the L.D. Bell Band. A band's worth is based on its sound. Tone quality is the key. While marching, keeping your sound smooth is imperative. If you want to play smooth, you have to be smooth. Solid marching fundamentals can make it happen. Position of attention. As with all aspects of what we do, marching band is based off the position of attention. At attention, the heels are together and toes are apart a fist's width, approximately 30 degrees. Check your points of alignment, ankles, hips, shoulders, and back of the head, to create a clean body line with the weight distributed at the 60% point.
The point here is not to say this is how you should march. The point here, well, it is for our students, not for you. The point here is going through the process of creating a fundamentals video and having to write that script. How do you bake a cake for marching band? Okay. A, it prevented this. Okay, seniors, how did we do this one last year? Right? Like, we've all been there. So we started that in 2000. It was on VHS tapes that we made for just the sophomores, because that's all the budget would allow, the incoming members. By 2004, we'd moved up to CD-ROMs, right? So, which by today's standards are also cost prohibitive, right? Because the internet is mostly for free. Going through that process, writing that script made us better teachers. It made me a better teacher, because you had to figure out exactly what it was that you wanted them to do. And if they weren't doing it, that was on you. Then, here's a CD-ROM, the students can teach themselves. They all have the same information. And then, when we get into physical warm-up at that contest, when we're actually focused and can really push that up the next couple notches, man, that's cool. Why? Because it's the same information. We're doing nothing different when we got to the contest than we did the very first day of summer band. Don Hill, composer, a little bit of behind the scenes. That's me taking a selfie with him before selfies were a thing. Like, there's no reverse camera. Yeah. You just take 20 of them. You know how that works, right? Well, maybe you don't. I don't know.
And now for a little episode of Inside Baseball, or How the Sausage is Made. So this is 2007, L.D. Bell, and the lessons to be learned from this is if you have the opportunity and the resources, get the show right. Make adjustments when you can, again, especially if you have time. But do that in the long run. It's a better thing to do that than keep rehearsing something that really doesn't work, because everybody knows it doesn't work, from you to the judges, and especially the kids. They know when it doesn't work. They can sense it. So anyway, short versions, 2007. The band was going great. The show design was going great. Wes was doing his thing with the trilogy. There was a vibe that was L.D. Bell at the time, and it was really cool. So this was a very important year, and the original opener to this show was a great piece of music. It was the Gulf Cathedral by Debussy, and it was taking kind of a chance because, those of you who know the piece, it's a big, long, long build. It was, it didn't have the ebb and flow of a lot of the things we do with short attention span theater. So this was taking a chance, and we did it, and it was okay. it was okay. And this was a national championship band. So we do it. The band learns it. The band performs it and competes with it. I come down to a rehearsal. Can't remember exactly where it was. It was early in the game. Went to a football game, and we're watching it, and we're all going, yeah, well, that's okay. And then Wes pulls me aside, and I knew ahead of time, because by this point we'd worked together long enough. It's like, here we go. It's like, you know, the opener's not working. And I'm going, I know. So we decide at that point to throw it out. And this is a band that was, I believe, we were second in 2006. I don't remember the placements, but we were there, you know, at the top. And it was a pretty big decision. And we had to kind of brainstorm. Now, luckily, and this gets into the realm of sometimes it's better to be lucky than good, I'd been in the movies.
We made Pan's Labyrinth, additionally, the opener. And I recall the day with the students, because we had to get through our UIL regionals before we could really do anything. That was on a Tuesday night. And on Wednesday, we handed out new, and we'd been designing it in the background. On Wednesday, we handed out the music, learned it, memorized it. On Thursday, we learned the drill. And on Friday, we learned the fifth part with all those little clouds that went. And then we all got on the bus and went down to San Antonio and went like this, right? Because what I told the members was, guys, I'm not a gambling person, but I've seen movies about gambling. And when you roll the roulette wheel, there's a lot of red and black. And then there's two spaces that are green. That's what we're going for right now. So put on your seatbelts. And of course, they knew that the beginning wasn't working. So they were relieved. They were psyched up about it. Let's get this done. Then they take the ownership to really get their parts learned and get their dots learned and get all that stuff to happen. And that's better instruction through redesign, because we were able to teach them more effectively when we had something more effective to teach them, and they learn more. Okay, so this is 2008. We designed this epic arrival that was gonna be awesome. People were gonna throw babies. It was gonna be awesome. And we watch it, we're like, this is so boring. Like, this is going on forever. The tessitura is not right. The step sizes are too small. I think at some level, they are still in Houston performing this today. Look! It won't end. Oh my. And I certainly like to thank Bands of America for putting that out online immediately so I could look at it and go, oh my, I'm bored with this. So we talked about this, great music, played great. Go back to the source material. This was from Stardust, the movie Stardust. And we just found another hit. Like, not a greatest hit, but there was an impact. All right, so here it is. Better. We could have spent the next month, we could have still be rehearsing that other part and it wouldn't have gotten any better. So sometimes, you know, you want to do it. Now you want to be strategic about it, not throw the baby out with the bathwater, but you know, every once in a while, you know, a little Clorox, clean things up. Which brings us to the spirit show. Many would say, well, you guys doing all this esoteric stuff, how could your home crowd enjoy that? And they mostly did, for the most part. You know, a lot of band parents in the crowd, right? So, I mean, these were the same people that put that refrigerator art up on the refrigerators. So, really, that was not a good litmus test for excitement. So, we came up with the spirit show. The spirit show is a drum transition, the A section of a pop tune, a stand tune. A drum transition with electronics, the A section of another pop tune. A drum transition with electronics, the A section of another pop tune. So we were able to put this all together. In fact, our stand tunes, we eventually only knew the A sections, and it was just fine. Because even up in the stands, we were able to play the Spirit Show sequence, and it sounded like we never stopped playing. Right? Because it's just more drums, and then the A section of this, and more drums, and then we played Ice Ice Baby, and more drums, and at that time, the boo-da, boo-ding, boo-ding, boo-da, yeah, boo-da, was a thing. Right? So we had two versions of that. One was it, and then the other one was with permission to groove, because nobody looks cool grooving in a band uniform, right? So, but every once in a while, we had to give them the permission to groove, and I just looked away. So we also were able to teach the students how to learn drill while having entertaining football games. One block, spell of letters, go back to the same block where you came from, and then do just like a trick geometry move back to where you came, and then spell something else. Raiders. Yay, we were the Blue Raiders, Blue Raider Band. And people are all trying to look, spell it. Sometimes the kids misspelled stuff, I don't know. But go back to the block. All right, you getting the picture here? First time my jaw was on the floor. Everybody stood up. They're all clapping to the steady beat. Music education for the crowd. And by the way, this is the only appropriate use of electronics right here. Trick move, back to the block. All right, and I told them on this one they could only go four steps outside of their spot. Those would be woodwind players, right? If the brass is playing. What song are you going to play when it's almost over? That's GE right there. Hear what you see what you hear. Right. Then I felt it was my job to run down and make it go faster. It took an hour. We used it to teach the students how to learn drill the first day. I was able to stand up in band parent meetings in May, and I promise, Friday Night Lights, the very first game, every student in this program will be in a suit of blue under the lights. And you roll into your first football game when your show is like ending halfway through the ballad, right? And not performed all that well. You do a drum cadence and throw that down. You know, not that you want to win halftime. I would never say that, but it's nice not to lose halftime, so. So we have covered the broad strokes of design, coordination, and instruction. And there's a design element to instruction itself, right? If I could leave you with one thing today, it is to play great music great. Great music, played great. And let us remember our end user in terms of our students, schools, and communities for which we serve. And I thank you.